Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to call our meeting to order. Mr. Clerk, would you please take roll call?
Dave Abdallah.
Here.
Bill Bazzi.
Here.
Robert Constant. Robert Constant. Robert Constant is absent. Lisa Hicks Clayton.
Here.
Denise Milanowski Maxwell.
Here.
Ray Muscat.
Here.
Tom Wenzel.
Here.
Madam Chair, you have a quorum.
Thank you. At this point, I'd like to have Councilman Wenzel lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everyone. Please be seated. Next, we have agenda approval.
Madam Chair.
Councilwoman Hicks Clayton.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Move to approve the order of business for July 14th, 2020, electronically held regular meeting of the Dearborn Heights City Council virtual meeting. This is an amended agenda as submitted, Madam Chair.
Support.
Support by Councilman Muscat. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Next, we have approval of minutes. This is minutes from the electronically held regular meeting of June 23rd, 2020.
Madam Chair.
Councilman Abdallah.
I move that we approve the minutes from June 23rd, 2020, electronically held regular meeting of the Dearborn Heights City Council virtual meeting as outlined in item 4A.
Support.
Support by Councilwoman Hicks Clayton. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? The ayes have it. Before we go further, I think Councilman Constant just joined us. Let's get him going on. Okay. Let's let the records note that Councilman Constant is now joining us for the meeting. Next, we have public hearing and comment on agenda items. This is for the audience to comment on the agenda. You have 2 minutes. Go ahead, anyone?
The mayor has
Dana Parrish. Go ahead.
Good evening, Madam Chair. I have comments on two agenda items. The first would be on agenda item 8C, the veto of motion approving resolution of the Dearborn Heights City Council related to the initiation of financial review. I don't understand what the intention of the veto from the mayor is. It is obviously his right as the mayor of the city to veto any motion by the city council, but I think it's a waste of time, and I think it's time for the city to get on with the business of conducting a financial review. We've been to court on this issue, and I hope his intentions are not to further delay the financial review, and that he doesn't end up taking this to court, costing residents of the city of Dearborn Heights further money. The next is on item 11A, Councilwoman Hicks Clayton, resolution of the city of Dearborn Heights City Council to subpoena records from the comptroller. I fully support her resolution to subpoena the records from the comptroller. Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Next, we have Councilman Muscat. Are you raise your hand?
Yes, I did.
You're commenting as a resident?
As a resident.
Okay, hold on. Let me restart this. Go ahead, please.
Thank you, Council Chair and honorable council members. Ray Muscat, 26911 Havelock Street. I'd like to comment on 8B, if I may do so, please. This is about the capital improvement bonds for the motion of 20-204. This has been in a progress for almost 10 years now. And in those 10 years, I'm sure the cost of labor and materials has gone up significantly in those 10 years. We are now put into a position on the 11th hour and 59th minute that we have to approve something. This has gone on too many times where this council and previous councils all had to do something in the last minute. by approving this, it's $16,300,000, but what the real cost of this is $30 million bond, not $16,300,000, but $30 million. I'll be approximately 96 years old when this bond gets paid off. I'll never see it being paid off. And I'm sure there are maybe city officials that will not run again for office, that will leave office and go to a different city and not have to pay this, okay? This is the legacy that we're leaving for the future generation of Dearborn Heights, is last-minute decisions, always last-minute decisions. And not to have had the input of the residents of this city for the last 10 years is unbelievable to me at best. Now, I know as a city councilman, I have a decision to make. I have no choice but how to vote for this now. The choice was taken away from me by waiting for the last minute for this project to be done. It's got to be done in the next 3 years. And this right here on 8B, the approximate cost of $16,300,000, the cost of this with everything else rolled in is $30 million. Remember that. And I'm very upset that I have to do what I got to do. And I'll apologize to the residents of this city now. Thank you and have a good day.
Thank you. I have Comptroller Vance. Did you mean to raise your hand? Can we find her?
I got her.
Okay. Comptroller, did you mean to raise your hand?
Yes, I did.
Are you?
Well, I'm not a resident, but I'd like to comment on an agenda item.
If you're commenting, fine, but if you're answering somebody's question, you can't do that.
I'm not answering anyone's question.
Okay.
Okay, so I am commenting on 11A regarding the ordinance, the resolution. In this resolution, it states that I am refusing to provide regular financial reports to the city council. I am not refusing to provide them, but the June financial statement is the year-end fiscal financial statement, and that financial statement is not done until all the closing entries are entered. It is not a common practice to submit anything prior to that being finalized. I have no problem submitting it when the financial report is ready and finalized. And that's what I'd like to say. I mean, it's the year-end report. It's not like a monthly report like the other ones. The monthlies are done on a cash basis. The year-end financial statement is done by accrual. And that's why it takes time to get this prepared. And that's why it takes several months for me to prepare it. And I have no problem giving it to the council when it is ready. So I wanted clarification on that.
Thank you. Next, we have Mayor. Hold on, let me unmute you. There you are. You're commenting as a resident?
Yes. I'm talking about 11A.
Okay.
What is the old saying? It is better to stay quiet than to speak and let the whole world know how little knowledge you have on a subject. Councilwoman Lisa Hicks Clayton is showing us how little knowledge she has on financial matters. And thank you for showing us this before the election for treasurer. It's important to have a year-end.
Madam Chair, point of order.
Councilwoman, point of order. Let him speak. He is speaking as president.
He's not allowed to talk about campaign material. It violates city council procedures, Madam Chair.
All right. City Clerk, can you please clarify that? Mr. Clerk?
Muted.
Yes, we should stay away from political... any kind of political things about people running for office.
Okay, then I will no longer allow that to continue. At this point, is there any other public hearings and comment on agenda items?
You have a hand raised.
I'm looking. Okay, Zoo here, let me unmute you. Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yes, you have 2 minutes. Go ahead.
First, good evening to everybody. Second, I want to thank all the employees who are standing at the doors to keep our residents safe. And please let me say this, And I want to comment on 8C. I believe our residents deserve to know the financial situation of the city after many, many, many years. We didn't do any audit except the Plant Moran audit. And looking at the audit reports from Plant Moran, there are so many things which are deficiencies which haven't been corrected for many, many years. And I think we don't need to waste more money. When $600 an hour, as the Vito claims, for a lawyer, or $675 for two lawyers joining in a meeting. Let's not forget that the mayor hired $500 an hour lawyer. So far, we spent over $100,000. And if we go to court on this issue, we're going to spend more money, which is enough, in my opinion, to do the forensic audit from the beginning to the end. I think we should come to our senses and stop this, back and forth fight. And let's get on with our business, because this is not your money. This is the residents' money. And we should do the forensic audit as soon as possible. And thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other comment on UPK? I have Vince.
Okay. Mike Blackburn has had his hand up for a minute.
Okay, I couldn't see that page. Can you take his hand down and lower his hand? Unmute him.
Then Corporation Counsel has his hand up as well. Okay.
Mr. Blackburn?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
This is on 8B. Whether you want to call it kicking the can down the road or the 11th hour, 10 years ago we were in a financial crisis, and it was work was postponed because of that. And I think this is a smart idea. I think it should get passed. And I want to say thank you in advance to all the council members that are going to vote yes for this. And that is it.
Thank you. Can you unmute Mr. Miyake?
I got it.
And this is on okay, there you go.
Very good. Gary Miyake, Plainfield Street. I wasn't going to comment, but I think that it would be appropriate to do so with regard to the mayor's veto. There are a number of things that are attributed to me. This is indeed accurate in terms of what it says. The legal concerns that have been raised are not insignificant, like knowing exactly what amount per hour will be paid to the accounting firm, which is unknown at this present time.
Okay, what you're doing, Mr. Miyake, is you're answering a question that somebody, you should just be commenting.
Council Chair, I'm perfectly free to do so as a resident, and even not as a resident, to end up commenting on any agenda item how I would see fit.
Right, but you are commenting as our corporate counsel attorney in regards to what you wrote.
I'm not given an opportunity to raise these issues if I try to raise them. So that's why I'm raising the issues at this point. And I'm not charging for the time, consistent with what I've stated to Councilman Bazzi before with respect to this. My point is that I don't think the mayor's veto nor the comments that I've raised have ended up having to say that you cannot do a financial review. It's just a comment about how it should end up being pursued and trying to make sure that, for example, you don't violate the Open Meetings Act, and that you also are in a position where you know, for example, are you paying $250 per hour for Raymond Robeson, or are you paying $375 per hour? Very simple things like that. Who's the contract with? There is no clarity with regard to that, because frankly, these issues should have been clarified in advance and they haven't been. So these issues should still be clarified. If they are, you can still proceed with your financial review. And I think until you know what's going to happen or have some sort of maximum amounts involved in this, any sort of an agreement, it's very difficult to say how much is going to end up being incurred with regard to this financial review.
Okay, we've gone out of time. Thank you. Any other council? I'm sorry, Mr. Vince. I'm going to unmute him. Go ahead.
I didn't have any comment. There was
You raised your hand.
I tried to erase it, but sorry.
Okay, no problem. Any other hands out there?
Not that I am seeing.
Okay, let's move on. Next, we have fund transfers and current claims.
Madam Chair.
Councilwoman Hicks Clayton.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I move to approve current claims 6-1 through 6-38 as submitted.
Support.
Report by Councilor Abdullah. Is there any discussion?
Council Chair.
Councilman Muscat.
On our legal pays, I think it's 6-6. Why do we have so much rhetoric going on and being charged about correspondence about covert the COVID situation? Letters here. I mean, this is something that lawyers are just going back and forth and making money on writing letters about the COVID. What I don't understand what's going on.
Councilman, I have to agree with you. The COVID comes down from our governor, and there really is not much more you can do with whatever she orders.
Yeah, and there's so much charging going on about the COVID. I understand we're going to pay it, but we need to curtail it a little bit here. Okay, we're spending a lot of money on something that's coming from the governor's office, and probably the attorney general's office has already looked at it. So that's my main concern about that. And the other one question I have is on 631, the water main. On that it says CDBG. Are they paying any part of this?
Director Hashem, he's here. So here he is. Director Hashem, are you there?
Okay. Can't answer part of that. This is John Jones only. This project was titled CDBG.
I can't even hear it.
That was the name of the project, and CDBG paid $250,000.
Can't understand what he's saying.
That's Director Salmi. You've got a poor connection on your internet. You're coming through garbled.
Which line item are you talking about, Councilman?
I believe it's 631. It's a water main, and it says CDBG on it. When I get them here, they're not numbered, so I kind of counted.
I would like to send this to Director Salome. I'm not really sure. We did contribute ourselves $250,000 to the water main. However, I really cannot speak of which one this is and what the cost is. If we did pay some money into it, that's probably what it is. We did contribute $250,000 last year to the water main, but I don't have the documentation to support which one. And Director Salome will be the one to answer that.
It's for water main $30,006.63.
Yeah.
I take that back. $45,579 and street construction $7,161. What part of that is CDBG money?
I don't have that information in front of me, Councilman. If we paid for it, again, we paid $250,000 toward a water main. And then I believe we did pay some money for the planning for the new water main, the engineering that is. Now, how Director Salome split that out, I don't know. I don't have that documentation in front of me. I think that question should be answered by the director.
Well, I'm asking somebody to give me a...
I didn't send that in, so I don't have the answer for that.
That's answer me, can you hear me?
DW. John, go ahead.
Can you hear me?
No.
How about if I give you a call tomorrow, Mr. Salmi, and maybe you can explain it to me, okay? Because I'm sure there's got to be a pretty good answer for it, because I'm looking at it now. It's account number 202-202-880.300, street construction, a 45,000 main streets here I'm looking at. I have to go back, and I'll give you a call tomorrow, and I apologize to City Council for taking up their time, but I'll give you a call tomorrow, Mr. Salmi.
All right.
That's good.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Is there any other discussion in regards to this agenda item number 6? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Next item on the agenda is consideration of bids. We have DPW Director Salmi bid award for city-owned lots grass cutting.
Madam Chair.
Councilor Odella.
I move that we concur with Public Works Director John Salmi, who has reviewed all the grass cutting bids received, and it is the recommendation of the department to that City Council that we award the contract to Artistic Landscaping and Lawn Service an amount of $4,000 per cut for all city-owned property listed in the bid document. And this takes effect on July the 1st, 2020
condition
through June 30th, 2022, as outlined in item 7A, and then also authorized to return the bid bonds outlined in 7A.
Support.
Support by Councilwoman Hicks Clayton. Is there any discussion?
Madam Chair.
Councilman Bazzi.
Again, you know, I'm not comfortable voting for this one. Like I mentioned before, you know, it's still items under 15. It asked companies to have worksman comp insurance, and this one particular company does not. You know, I looked it up again, and it still does not have it. And I know that the director mentioned that somebody, they can hold us, you know, there's a harmless agreement. I don't agree with that. We still, the city of Dearborn Heights is still liable if any of their employees get hurt on a job. I think a city of Dearborn Heights is still liable. So again, I'm not comfortable with that, voting on this one. And, you know, just because somebody doesn't have insurance, you know, they give an edge over this contract. And I'm, you know, what the director McIntyre mentions, you know, like, you know, he's trashing another company, which is pretty unprofessional, you know, and I have not heard anything bad about any of that. I mean, even our, you know, this particular company, you know, it's just not right to bash a company just to boost one company. And I don't even know why we're even putting up for bids if he's still favoring a company over another company. So I'll be voting no on this one.
Yes, I just wanted to comment about the workman's comp insurance. When you're hiring a contractor, you need the liability insurance. We are not liable if he doesn't have workman's comp. That's in between an employer and the employees. So that's why the city, when we do our bids, we ask for liability insurance, because it doesn't fall on us if he has the insurance or not for his employees. It falls on the liability insurance if something happens while they're mowing and you know, they smash into a vehicle or whatever accident or something happens. So I just wanted a little clarification.
Well, the contract asked for it. It's under Section 815. So if you're not going to do that, why put it in a contract?
When the contractor signs the contract with the city, that will have to be provided for us to award the contract.
Yeah, we get riders for that once contracts are signed.
And the other thing is, we asked DPW to also quote the same jobs. I have not seen anything from DPW. I asked that a few months back before COVID, that when you guys put this in front of us, we'd like to find out what it would take to bring it in-house and for DPW to do the same job. And that has not been provided yet.
So with the quote that's provided, it's going to be about anywhere from $48,000 to $56,000 for the entire season to cut the grass. That would barely employ one employee with benefits and legacy costs. So And currently we're down four positions. To try to hire people right now is very difficult. Is something they looked at hard, and that's the best response that I can give you that is most cost effective to do it this way.
Okay. Dr. McIntyre, did you have your hand up? Hold on.
No.
I got Councilman Abdullah next.
Yeah, I didn't bash a company. I told you what I was getting from a company. I did mention that when I first came here, and I put the disclaimer in there that what I was referring to had nothing to do with the contractors that are applying for this position. I made that very clear. But I did wanted to show you the progression of when I first came here, we had a lot of contractors that I felt were overinflating invoices, and we're now with a company that I've never, ever had to be concerned about that. So if you heard it that way, Councilman Bazzi, I apologize if you heard it that way. So that was not my intention to do that. But I will say I was asked directly by one of your colleagues to tell me the difference of good and bad of why I'm going with the company that I'm recommending. And I thought I did it very diplomatically. I thought I did it respectfully by just going with the compliments of the company that we have. The reason the other question you said is why are we going out for bid? Well, you asked me to go out for bid. I never wanted to go out for bid. I wanted to stay with the company that's doing the best job. So.
Okay, next we have Councilman Constant. Did you still have something to say?
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. Councilman Bazzi, do you mean that Artistic doesn't have workers' comp insurance for their employees? You're not saying that they should have workers' comp. That you're saying that Artistic, it appears to you that Artistic does not have workers' comp for their Artistic employees. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay.
It's under Section 15 in the contract.
And did you all receive a letter from Artistic's insurance agent where he carries his coverage? Because I got one, and I assume that you were all copied on it, where it states that he has liability coverage twice the amount that we're asking for. And he has workers' compensation insurance. So I'm not sure.
We have Councilman Abdullah next, please.
This is for Director McIntyre. I just wanted to get a clarification, and that's not the main factor, but it's a factor for me. I always prefer that we go with local companies, local Dearborn Heights companies that are from Dearborn Heights. So the question I have for you, the third company was not had nothing to do with Dearborn Heights. I really think in this particular case, it really should be a local company because of the logistics. Mr. Constant?
Are you working? Right.
Anyways. Okay. So I prefer somebody in Dearborn Heights. And the question I have for you, I know Artistic is in Dearborn Heights. The other one has a P.O. box. I'm asking, are they, because you mentioned only one of them is in Dearborn Heights. So I'm just want to get a clarification. Is the second company located is either in Dearborn Heights or extremely close to Dearborn Heights?
I know they're not located in Dearborn Heights. They may have been at one time, but they're not anymore. But I can't tell you where exactly their truck yard is or where their office is, but it's not in Dearborn Heights. So
Is it a neighboring city?
All I can tell you is I believe he told me at one time that he himself resides in Milford, but I don't know where his business is located. I do think he has a yard that is in a neighboring city, like where he stores some vehicles.
Okay. And the second question I have for you, and this may be appropriate, awkward, or just, but I'm just going to talk about the elephant in the room. Does anybody in the city, and I'm just, this is across the board, everybody from A to Z in the city, have any type, so this is not meant towards somebody specific, have any type of affiliation, financial gain, et cetera, from any one of these companies that we as council are considering?
I don't know if any council people have used either of these companies in the past. I think maybe one has, one council person, but for me personally, no.
So there's no financial gain or family affiliation, et cetera?
No.
Okay. None. That you're aware, I mean, you should be aware of it, obviously.
Well, I can speak only for myself. No, absolutely not.
But none that you're aware of, at least.
None that I'm aware of, no.
Okay, thank you.
We have Councilman Muscat next.
No, I'm sorry. I hit the button by accident. Sorry.
Okay, any further discussion on agenda item 7A?
I do have one question, if you don't mind. I'm sorry, but I didn't realize that I could actually put this on the agenda today because I thought I had to wait for the study session before I could do that. I guess Mr. Salmi was more savvy than I was and just assumed that this was the study session was going to take place today. I know that what's up on the agenda right now is just Mr. Salmi's bid for the what we call the city cuts out of DPW. Are we also considering my bid at this point?
It's not on the agenda. We've already
received it. So I could just bring it back at another time.
Yeah, bring it on the next one.
Okay, I'll do that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay, any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
Councilman Bazzi is opposed. The ayes have it. Next item on the agenda is report from Mayor. This is Major Local Streets Budget for 2021.
Madam Chair.
Councilman Thompson.
I move we adopt the Major and Local Street Budget for fiscal year 2020 and 2021 as submitted as outlined in item 8A.
Support.
Support by Councilwoman Hicks Clayton. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
Councilman Bazzi is opposed. The ayes have it. Next item on the agenda is response to City Council Motion 20204, Intent Resolution for Capital Improvement Bond.
Oh, that's
Council Chair.
No, you're going
C. That's number B, 8B. It says response to Council Motion 20-204.
No, you skipped one, Council Chair.
No, I did the Major and Local Streets Budget for 2021. No. 8A. This is 8B we're on.
Okay, we're on 8B.
Correct. Okay.
Everybody okay with that? Okay, let me read it again. Response to Council Motion 20-204, Intent Resolution for Capital Improvement Bonds.
Madam Chair.
Councilman, I'm sorry, who do we have here?
Dave Abdallah.
Councilman Abdallah.
So I'm just going to do the motion just to open it up for discussion, because obviously this is a very important subject. I move that we concur with Mayor Dan Paletko, who has sent the administration request to have a town hall, who had mentioned that the city council sent the administration a request to have a town hall meeting on the intent resolution for capital improvement bonds for city council motion 20-204, a copy of which is attached. And he went on to mention how this would be hard to orchestrate such a meeting during COVID-19. And the state of Michigan has mandated that the L43, L41, and L42 CSO projects be completed within the next three years. And this has an approximate cost of $16,300,000. A bond would spread this cost over many years as reflected in the current and future water budgets prepared with the assistance of Plant Moran. And he mentions that without bonding, this cost would drastically increase in water rates over the next few years. Again, he mentions there's no option not to, and it's capitalized, to do or pay for the improvements. The only options are to bond or pay for these improvements as the work is done. And this is as outlined in item 8B.
Support.
Support by Councilman Constan. Is there any discussion?
Council Chair.
Councilman Muscat.
We had a study session on this. And what we discussed was a $30 million bond. And here it's only $16,300,000. One, I'd like to know what we're going to be approving here. Is it just a 16.3 or close to $30 million? And as far as the other things that were spoken about earlier today in the public comments about the city was not in a financial position to do this, that's hogwash, okay? This was something that would have been paid for anyway. It's been 10 years. I'll bet you this has increased at least $2 million, if not more, since that time. So we're just getting more money. Yes, I understand how important it is, but that's hogwash about we were in financial trouble. We could have done this anytime in the last 10 years, not just today.
Okay. Mayor, that's my comment for it.
I'm muted, Mayor. Go ahead.
Okay. What that the resolution that needs to be passed, it should, I unfortunately didn't include it, but that is the resolution that was done by bond counsel with a notice of intent. My concern is, and actually I would have also included the $800,000 that we were looking at in changing the lead leads to people's homes. So what I basically did was take out the water meter project and thought that that might be, because that's discretionary. But these three projects are mandated because City of Dearborn was forced by the state to do their CSO projects. Inkster has done theirs. And we're just, the strip area of Dearborn Heights is in the middle and the state wants to get that done. So the resolution that really needs to be passed was that resolution that bond council prepared. I was simply lowering the figure down because I don't see how we can get out of the L43, 41, and 42 CSO projects, but the water main is discretionary. And I would also, so I kind of came up with a number, but that's what I did. I took that project out, but if I had it all over to do, I would have put the 800,000 in for the changing the lead leads to the people's homes.
Council Chair?
Councilman Bazzi's next. Are you still talking?
Well, that was in response to what I was going to keep saying here.
Okay, go ahead.
Because it does concern just the 16 million. 300,000, and I do also believe the water meters are not mandatory, but I do believe that the water main leads to the homes must be included. So if the project was $800,000, that should be included in this motion, because we can't have people with lead in their water. Can't have it. I won't vote on this at all if that's not included. People need to have safe drinking water today.
Councilman John Salmi has a comment. Go ahead, please.
Yes, thank you. Just a couple of clarifications here. The lead line replacement program is already in place. It's already a budgeted item in the current water and sewer budget. We are moving forward with that. That's not a part of this bond sale. The L43 is underway now. That construction is currently started last week. That could be part of the bond sale, but the lead service line is a budgeted item, and this budget it's not anything to do with the upcoming bond sale if the council decided to go in that direction. L43 is a funded project within this current budget also. The thought was from the bond council was to use the money from the bond sale to help pay L43 so you didn't drain down the cash account in the water fund.
I'm confused.
Madam Chair. Councilman Bazzi next.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Yeah, this is also, I mean, I don't agree. I mean, with today's technology, we can still have the town hall meetings with, virtual meeting with residents. The other thing is, Director Salmi already answered. We already budgeted for the lead issue, and the other thing is the vagueness of this thing here. You know, you're mentioning okay, approximate cost of $16,300,000, and again, you know, it's approximate. There's no actual cost, and also you're talking about the cost. This cost over many years as reflected in the current water budget. So, I mean, it's pretty vague. And again, you know, I don't feel comfortable voting for this much money without residents' engagements.
Okay, next we have Councilman Lustyak.
Again, I'm gonna, I know as long as it's $16,300,000, because that's what's on the paper. If this is what we're gonna be voting on, I'm okay with it. I just don't want it to come back and say, well, it was for the 30 million that we were talking about. So 16,300 is what we're going to vote on. Am I correct?
What's it for?
Did anybody answer that?
It says approximate.
Well, yeah, but approximate is not $30 million.
No, what we need to do, and I'll bring it up at the next meeting, is bond council is not part of this meeting, but bond council get very conservative, so they'll jump it up a little bit higher than $16.3 million. But my intent was that with the ongoing of L-43 and having to do 41 and 42, that we bond for that. I apologize for the 800,000. I stood corrected. I appreciate John saying that. But what you would be voting on is a notice of intent. So you're not issuing bonds right now. They're not making, all you're doing is doing a notice of intent, but it has to be specific to the language. And I would defer to Mr. Miyake. I don't have that here, and I'm at home, not in the office. So I don't have a copy of that last.
I think that's a pretty good explanation on what's going on here. And if it's an intent, I'm good with it. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, next we have Councilman Constant, and then Councilman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Yeah, I don't hear anyone saying that as far as the improvements to the sewer system that are mandated, that we shouldn't do them. They're required. The issue is how we're going to pay for them. And if we don't bond, if we upped our water rates 400%, it would be a disaster. If we had a town hall meeting, I would think generally, number one, we'd be the first city that has a town hall meeting about issuing municipal bonds. And number two, the residents will just hear, oh, you know, we're going to be spending money to improve our sewers. People are going to say, oh, you know, we should have volunteers, we should be doing it cheaper. But all I could say is better late than never. But this is obviously an expense we have to bond out for. And it's a fairly long, complicated process. And as has been indicated, we're not voting to issue the bonds. We're voting to start the process and go through the legal requirements that have to be done. Otherwise, we have to say we're not doing the work.
Okay. Next, we have Councilman
Adella. I had a couple different questions. The first question, because of the COVID situation right now, and a lot of people either out of work or making less money, or their business is not making the same amount of money, personally, I'd rather delay any type of charges to the residents as much as possible. So the first question I have, and I'm going to ask four different questions, I'm going to make them short, is can this, and they're kind of interrelated. One of them is, can this be delayed? The second question is, if we did not bond this out, can the city, you know, can we pay out of the money that we've got, and how much would that cost annually if we had no bond? The third question is, if we did bond it out, how much cost would that be to the average resident? So based on average SCVs, the equalized value and the millage rate for that, and I'm sorry, the bond rate for that, how much would it cost the average resident? And the last thing is a comment that I want to make is, I tell you, based on my business, obviously the interest rates are unbelievably low right now. So that particular advantage, I see it, but at the same time, if this can be delayed and have our residents pay for this a little bit later, it would be to our advantage. So if somebody can answer the three questions: can it be delayed? How much cost would it cost to the city if we did not bond it? And what would the average homeowner pay for this type of a bond if we bonded it today?
Now we have Director Tom. Go ahead, please.
Yep, I can answer the first one anyway. So on June 30th, I sent an email to the Deputy Director of Eagle regarding the permits that this falls under. I told him, I asked him that the city is planning and is in the planning and financing process of the three Rouge outfalls. The city council is requesting something in writing from Eagle for these projects are mandated or part of the permit to make the city in compliance. He wrote back, "Will do. Let me talk with permit section and the district and respond. Yes, correction is required. Thanks." And I haven't received anything since. So I am proactively reaching out to them to see if there's, you know, a time frame that we can push this down, you know, push it out a year or so. But I mean, it's not going to be something long term. It's, to your point, it would be something short term.
But even for what's short term, Director, at least it'll give people a little bit of a chance to get back into the norms of making whatever income, you know, most people had. I know people are struggling nowadays. I know there's the unemployment that they pay and all that, but obviously it's ending at the end of this month, so I'd rather delay that. And then the second question was, how much would it cost the city if we went with this but did not bond it out?
Yeah,
is that at all possible, and how much would that be?
Yeah, so I can't give you that number off the top of my head. We'd have to redo the model, because when we did the model, was with the $26 million in there. If you did it solely on the back of rates, it would be significant. But my suggestion would, maybe we have another study session with bond council and with Plant Moran. We can lower that number, and you can look at what it does to the rates with a bond and without a bond.
And does anybody know, based on the bond that's being proposed, how much the average resident would pay extra per year in taxes?
Well, so it's not a tax, right? So this is a utility, yeah,
right?
Utility bond, right?
Right, so right, right.
It's repaid through the enterprise fund of water. Right. But again, you know, last time we were talking about 29, now we're talking about 16. So I don't have an answer for you, but a study session, or I can definitely reach out to Plant Moran and get you an answer.
So I'm going to tell you personally, I'd like to kick this out to a study session. I'm not ready to vote on this, or else I'm going to vote no right now.
And I would like to at least get better response back from Eagle regarding this matter. So that way that would make the council a little bit more comfortable, also stating that, you know, here, because I know a couple of council people have said, well, we don't have anything in writing. But this permit has been negotiated over years, and Dan Brooks has more history with this than I do in this community, but in another community, they had the same challenges and were part of these types of permits. So, but proactively, I did reach out to them June 30th, so I'm still waiting for a further response.
Thank you.
If I might recommend, I felt an obligation to bring this back because the water rates would be just staggering. And as a rate payer myself, I would not want my rates to go up 100 or 200%. What I would suggest, if you want to refer this back to me, and if the council chair will give us a date on when we can have a committee of the whole meeting, we'll bring back Plant Moran, Dan Brooks from Wade and Trim, and bond council, and talk about this again.
Council chair, council chair.
Yes.
We're again. You know, I raised a big stink about this, but the fact of the matter is it was explained that this is the intent to bond. We're not bonding anything. So if we're just going to have an intent to bond, I think we should be able to go vote for that intent of bonding and still have the study session. Would that be correct, Mr. Mayor?
As long as you pass the motion as bond council wrote it up, and you have to change the amount because he put in like $30 million, and that would not be the correct amount. But this is very legalese, and I don't know what Gary Miatke, what would you suggest, Gary?
Gary has to be unmuted.
Yes, George, are you unmuting him?
Yep, I'm getting him.
Yes, I would suggest that the matter be referred back to the administration, scheduled for a study session or committee of the whole meeting, in order to make sure that all of the information is clear before there would end up being a vote. That would be my recommendation.
Okay, let's go ahead and do that. So, do you
want to
amend your?
Mr. Abdallah, Councilman,
yes.
Abdallah,
you're going
to.
That was Councilman Abdallah.
Yes. Can you hear me? Yep. Okay. I'd like to amend my motion that we move item 8B to a study session.
Support. Okay. Support.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? We'll move to a study session. I will figure it out when we can do this.
Madam Chair.
Councilwoman Hicks Clay.
The mayor asked that it be referred back to the administration as well. Is that a separate motion or included in that motion?
Was that included in that, Councilman?
That we amend what? There's some noise.
The mayor asked that it be referred back to the administration as well as a study session. So That wasn't included in the motion, but.
So I'd like to amend the motion to be moved to a study session and move it back to the administration.
Can I support that?
I have right now, Councilman,
question, hand raised. Yeah, I just wanted to say that, you know, I'm pretty disturbed about the fact that we were going to vote and there were some people who were actually ready to vote on something that we don't even know. Yeah, I know we're recommending it, suggesting it, the amount was spent, what's going to be spent, what's going to be spent on. It was ridiculous that we even had this discussion with all these figures being thrown around and contradicted. I was really dismayed. I almost walked out of the room because there was money, 800,000, not 800,000, doing this, doing that. And then, okay, let's vote on it. I was really upset about that.
I do believe that we settled that, so.
Yeah, I know, but.
This meeting is going so long. Let's try and shorten our comments into some, okay. But I agree with you. Go ahead, please. We're gonna be referring it back to administration. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? There you go. Okay, next item on the agenda is veto of motion approving resolution of the Dearborn Heights City Council related to the initiation of financial review. At this time, I'd like to ask Mr. Clerk, would you please read the charges?
Section 713, veto by mayor. The mayor shall have the power of the veto of resolutions and ordinances passed by the council, provided that the said veto, with the mayor's reasoning in writing, must be filed with the city clerk at least 24 hours before the date of the next regular meeting of the council, at which said meeting, the clerk shall present such veto or vetoes to the council. The council may, only at said meeting, reconsider the vote at which such proceedings were passed and adopted, and if so elects, may only at said meeting readopt such proceedings by a 5/7 vote of all the members elected, in which event the veto shall be overridden, and it will bar the right of the mayor from future vetoes of the proposed legislation. Such proceedings will then become effective on the following day succeeding such meeting of the council, and ordinances so passed shall become effective immediately thereupon publication. No ordinance, resolution, or other proceedings shall be published until the meeting following the meeting at which said ordinance, resolution, or proceeding was adopted.
Okay, at this time, I'd like to reintroduce the possible reconsideration of approved motion 20-208, resolution of the Dearborn Heights City Council to initiate financial review. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Is there going to be a discussion?
We usually don't discuss on an override on a veto.
Don't we have to make a motion on that, though?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You need a motion.
I need someone to motion. Sorry.
Council Chair.
Councilman Muscat.
I move council reintroduce. Reconsideration of a approved motion 20-208 resolution of the Dearborn Heights City Council to initiate a financial review as outlined in 9A.
Support.
Support by Councilman Bazzi. All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed?
No.
Okay, we're going to have to take a roll call then. At this time, I'm going to ask Councilman Constant, how are you voting?
No.
Councilman Bazzi, how are you voting?
Yes.
Councilman Muscat, how are you voting?
Yes.
Councilwoman Hicks Clayton, how are you voting?
Yes.
Councilman Wenzel, how are you voting?
Yes.
Councilman Abdullah, how are you voting?
No.
And Melanowski Maxwell is yes. We have overridden the veto. Is that correct, Mr. Clerk?
Oh, gosh.
Yes.
I'm sorry, Madam Chair, I did not hear what you said.
Okay. Is that you've overridden the veto?
Yes.
Yes, we have a record of that.
Okay, at this time, I'd like to say on Thursday, June 11th, 2020, the Michigan appeals moved in favor of Dearborn Heights City Council in its writ of mandamus lawsuit against Mayor David Lesko. The Court of Appeals affirmed the prior rulings of the Honorable Judge Muriel Hughes that Mayor Pulisic failed to fulfill the duties of his office by refusing to sign the engagement letter with the law firm Otten West, Tawil, and Shank PLC in pursuit of the council's financial review of city affairs. The Court of Appeals agreed with the city council that they had a clear legal right to hire Otten West's firm to assist with the financial investigation, and that the mayor had a clear legal duty to sign the retainer agreement with the Otten West firm after the council overrode the mayor's veto. The Court of Appeals also found that Mayor Pluckel wasted the city council's time and resources, as well as causing unnecessary drain on judicial resources by pursuing the appeal. That is all in their opinion. Despite losing in the court on an appeal, the mayor continued to delay a lawful investigation by issuing a veto on a unanimous council resolution to proceed with the investigation. In that statement, the mayor reiterated his old argument. The mayor's veto statement is actually inaccurate about several items, including but not limited to the unsupported and false claims that the attorneys have been present for all interviews conducted so far. When Attorney Shank has only attended one such interview, and that was with the outgoing treasurer prior to his retirement. And his dishonest arguments about the $250 an hour billable rate for council attorneys when Mayor Pluckel signed an agreement with two firms to represent him at rates up to $600 per hour. And the mayor's flawed and continued insistence that financial review is unnecessary because the city books are audited by Pat Moran, when the mayor should certainly understand that two scopes of service are entirely different. The mayor and Attorney Miyake's unsupported and false claims that an assignment agreement was not provided to the City of Dearborn Heights Council, as well as the false claim that the utmost firm has been dissolved, and the mayor refusing to recognize that cooperative purchase agreements such as my deal are standard practice for most municipalities in the state of Michigan. Mayor Pluckel is dangerously close to malfeasance in office by vetoing a resolution to implement a contract that has been lawfully approved by the city and blessed by the courts. It's deeply disturbing that Attorney Gary Miyake has assisted in drafting the veto message for Mayor Pluckel. The contract and the investigation are legal. The city's attorney is supposed to represent the city, yet he is charging the city for time to provide the mayor with political cover. If his legal advice had been better from the beginning, we all would have saved a lot of money. At this point, I will move on to the next agenda item. This is item 9B. It's the City of Dearborn Heights proposed sanitation village renewal. This is for City of Dearborn Heights proposed sanitation renewal. Councilman Abdella?
I move that we concur. Doesn't say who we concur. Are we just not on file there? Oh, I'm sorry. I move that we concur with Mayor Dan Palatko for the City of Dearborn Heights proposed sanitation millage renewal. And the City of Dearborn Heights shall be authorized to renew the levy previously approved under Section 10, Period 1 of the City Charter of up to 0.9540 of 1 mil for 10 years commencing on 2021. And this is as outlined in item 9B.
Support
by Councilman Constan. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
The ayes have it. Next we have DPW Director Selmy. This is bidding specifications and bidding assistant roofing technology associates LTD.
Madam Chair.
Councilman Abella.
I move that we concur with Public Works Director John Selmy. The Department of Public Works is requesting approval to engage the professional services of Roofing Technology Associates Limited. RTA will assist the city with the roofing specifications and bidding documents for the replacement of the roof at the City Hall. The proposal cost is $8,600 and is budgeted in the City Building and Maintenance Department capital outlay, and also to authorize payment as outlined in item 9C.
Support.
Support by Councilman Constan. Is there any discussion?
Madam Chair.
Councilman Abdella?
I think Councilman Bazzi was first. Go ahead.
Okay. Councilman Bazzi?
Well, you made the motion, so you can go first.
Yeah, that's why.
Okay. I had a question for, thank you, Councilman. So I have a question for Director Selmy. I have a very serious problem, and maybe clarify it for me. But if we're going to go out for bids for a roofing contractor to do the roof on the city, you know, at City Hall, $8,600 for somebody to do the bidding for us, you know, just logically, I have a problem with that. If we had it out for bids to replace the roof, and obviously whoever is replacing roof, company A, B, or C would also have the specifications. In my mind, at least, I can't clarify why we need to pay an additional $8,600 for a company to do the bidding for us. Can you clarify that for me, please?
Well, to the best of my ability. So the not just the bidding, more the specifications than the bidding package, right? So that's a 1950 down there. There's
you got cut off, director. If you don't mind repeating that again.
It seems to be the iPhone Tom seems to be the one.
Mute yourself if you're going to make noise.
All right. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, much better.
Okay. So as far as the technical part of that, that's beyond my scope. The roof, I'm told, has three layers on there. It needs to be stripped down to the deck. The specifications come in as the type of material, the warranties, the workmanship. I reached out to Waitrim. They didn't have anybody in-house that could do that kind of work. And this is how we found this company. This is what they do. They assist a lot of commercial businesses and developing the specifications to go out to bid. You know, I can put a bid spec together and, you know, and for it comes in and the roof leaks in a year because of my inability to know exactly what type of material and how to install it and warranties and stuff like that. I would suggest this is like an insurance policy, but I mean, this is a recommendation to the council and the council can do, you know, what
sure.
they choose.
And ignore my ignorance on this. I'm just thinking logically here. And I know, I know a home is much easier, obviously.
Yeah.
But if I was getting a company to do concrete or roof or add a garage or whatever it is, I mean, I get 3, 4, 5, 6, whatever it is, different bids. And I take a look at them and I just see which one jives best. Maybe in this particular case, maybe if you get 4 or 5 bids, you could show it to Plant Moran and maybe at a much cheaper cost, we could make a determination. Or maybe you could use the previous company that you used in the past. It just seems like a lot of money for somebody to help us out with this part. I honestly, sure. I'm not understanding it.
Yeah. So, well, I did reach out to the company that did a couple other city buildings and it's about $350,000. My thought was the council would be a little bit uncomfortable with me coming there and say I want to award a contract for $350,000 to this contractor to do the roof. But if that's the direction of the council, I'll gladly do that. I mean, I'm just trying to follow the charter and do the things the right way. And in all honesty and transparency here, I'm not a commercial roof expert by any means. And so I was looking for some assistance. And this is something that we spoke about in the budget hearings. And so trying to move this forward. You know, obviously we're into July, you know, before we know it's going to be October, November, before we, you know, like to get a roof on before the end of the year. But certainly I'll take some, you know, advice from council and do whatever it is that they prefer me to do.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, next we have Councilman Bazzi.
Okay, so this is, again, you know, I have the same issue with the 8,600. I saw an email a few weeks ago, I can't remember. I was trying to look for it earlier. I know we have it. It was addressed to all the council, and also it was directed at the director, Mr. Salmi, that this company was going to they were going to come and do the same thing for free. So they were going to give us the same service for free. But I've never seen any email traffic that was replied to all the council, and including the person that who sent that email. So what was the outcome of that email, Mr. Stelman?
I personally don't recall seeing that email, but I could have. But I think if I recall the one you were talking about, they were interested in bidding on the project is what they said. I'm sure I have it somewhere. I mean, if you guys don't want me to do this, I'm okay with that. And I'll go knock on 3 doors and bring 3 vendors in. My concern is, though, I'm not the expert on type of roofing and how that is installed, how the 3 roofs are removed down to the decking to assure that this roof has a 30-year lifespan. You know, I'm open for suggestions. I'm not here to work for this guy or anybody. I'm just trying to do the right thing for the taxpayers. So whatever your direction is, I'll be glad to do.
I would recommend going back to that company who actually it did say that they want to come and do an inspection of the roof for free.
So I'd have the company that has done two other city buildings for $350,000 was his estimate. Would the council be comfortable with me just coming to the council and say, okay, go ahead, I want you to approve this guy for $350,000, and then a lot of the things that we do here, the council wants them to be bid out, so I'm trying to bid it out. So I'm getting a little contradiction here, so I just need some direction.
Thank you. Okay, Councilman Muscat, I already had you written down. You got your hand up again.
Yes. Thank you, Council Chair.
Go ahead.
To everybody involved, replacing a roof on a commercial building is far, far different than replacing a roof on a home. Commercial and home are two different things. I believe City Hall has a metal decking, which could be rotted out. I think the $8,600 would be wise to spend for a complete inspection and give the Director Selmy some idea what he's really dealing with. He doesn't know, I don't know, until you can ready to get in there and dig and find out. To me, the $8,600 to me is a good insurance policy of knowing exactly what you got to do. And that's a very old building anyway. $8,600 is cheap. And I really want my colleagues to really consider approving that $8,600.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Okay, at this time we will take a vote. I need all on council members unmuted. I'm getting Councilman Wenzel right now. Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
Okay, we need to take a roll call. Councilman Muscat.
Yes.
Councilman Bazzi.
No.
Councilwoman Hicks Clayton.
Yes.
Councilman Abdella.
No.
Councilman Constan.
Yes.
Councilman Wenzel.
Yes.
Malinowski Maxwell, yes. It passes. Next item on the agenda is DPW Director Selmy, Johnson Control Service Agreement.
Madam Chair.
Yes. Councilman Constan.
I move that just for discussion that we concur with DPW Director John Selmy and have the mayor and clerk sign the service agreement with Johnson Controls for HVAC service for City Hall and the attached city buildings as outlined in 9D. The service contract for a year will be $57,120 as outlined in 9D.
Support.
Support by Councilor Muscat. Is there any discussion?
Yes, Madam Chair.
Councilman Constan.
So, John, is this, if we have a problem, we call them air balancing, all that included, and why is it so much?
It's based on hours. You buy so many hours within the contract. And it's actually discounted at 27%. And it's off the Sourcewell bid projects, and it's $100 more than what we paid last year.
And does a qualified person come out that knows what they're doing, or yes. Is it just a tech?
No. So they're qualified people. They're the same company that's worked with the city for at least 10 to 15 years that I'm told. So they're very familiar with the systems, the operations. So it's not like, it's not a apprentice program.
Yeah, I mean, we had a lot of problems with Johnson Controls at the Justice Center, but that was shortly after the building was built. All right, thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other questions directly related to this agenda item? All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? The ayes have it. Next, we have DPW Director Selmy, 2019 Street Paving Program, Lewis Manor Subdivision Paving. Change order number 3, approval and a certificate for payment number 4.
Madam Chair.
Councilman Muscat.
I move council approve and concur with Director Selmy on a 2019 street paving program, Lewis Manor subdivision paving, change order number 3 approval and certificate for payment number 4 as outlined in 9E.
Support.
Support by Councilwoman Hicks Clayton. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Next item on the agenda, DPW Director Salami, building maintenance equipment purchase and payment for 2420 Ford F250 4x4 pickup truck.
Council Chair.
Councilman Muscat.
I move council approve the building maintenance equipment purchase and payment of 2020 Ford F250 4x4 as outlined in 9F.
Support.
Support by Councilman Constant. Is there any discussion?
Madam Chair.
Madam Chair.
And then I've got Councilman Jesse.
I'm sorry, who was the first?
Councilman Abdullah and then
Councilman. Oh, okay. This is for Director Selmy. I mean, can you give us a little bit more information as to why we need these right now? What's happened to put you in a situation where we're going to need 2 pickup trucks?
Well, these are pickup trucks, so sure. So these are budgeted items in the current budget. They will replace a 2005 F-150 that, you know, is in dire need of repair. We're throwing bad money after bad money. And the second one would replace a 2010 pickup.
How much roughly mileage is there on each one, especially the 2010? I'm curious.
10's got 75,000 miles. The other one's got 117,000 miles.
So for the one at 75,000 miles, I'm just trying to get an understanding of this. Is that it's a lot of miles, but for normal everyday cars, that's fine. I'm just wondering for this type of stuff.
Yeah. And the difference also being that those are 150s. They don't have plows. They're basically, I don't know, lack of a better word, just, you know, plain old pickup. The boxes are rusted out on them. Some of the floorboards are rusted out of them. You know, to be more effective and efficient is my recommendation that we purchase the 250s. They come with plows. They come with bed liners. They're now more of a work truck than a 150, which is basically, we can't even put a plow on a 150.
Okay, thank you.
Actually, I can ask the same questions. What are those trucks for? So that was answered. Thank you.
You're welcome, Councilman.
Yeah, you know, just to reiterate what Deputy or the Director Selmy said, you know, 77,000 miles on an F-150 pickup truck. If I was driving it, it's not even broken in yet. You put that same mileage on a pickup truck that DPW use it, you might as well say it's got 300,000 miles on it. So you know, the way the vehicles are used, we've got to take in consideration.
Okay, thank you. Councilman Wenzel.
Yeah, John, can you clarify, you say they come with plows or plow?
Yeah. So they come completely outfitted. They come with plow package, four-wheel drive, come with a utility light package on there for safety. It's got all the amber lights, bed liners.
So they're completely plows. Outfitted.
Pardon me, sir?
Actual plows on them?
Yep, completely outfitted, turnkey.
Thank you.
Any further discussion? Okay, let's take a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Next we have DPW Director Selmy, highway equipment purchase and payment. Oh wait, this is again, okay, is this a separate one?
Yes, this is for highway.
I gotcha, I just realized, okay. DPW Director Selmy, highway equipment purchase and payment for 2020 F-250 4x4 pickup trucks.
Council Chair.
Councilman Muscat.
Again, I move council concur with Director Selmy on the purchase of 2020 Ford F-250 4x4s for the highway equipment as outlined in 9G. And the same sentiments go about this truck's as the other ones.
Okay.
Support
by Councilman Constant. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Next we have Fire Chief Brogan. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. No, this is another one. Okay.
One more.
Director Selmy, highway equipment purchase and payment for 2020 Freightliner chassis and build out.
Madam Chair.
Councilman Abdullah.
I move that we concur with John Selmy, Director of Public Works, requesting a purchase and to authorize the payment upon receipt of a 2020 Freightliner single axle chassis from Wolverine Freightliner in the amount of $86,685. That's for the truck and trailer specialties, for the build out of this dump truck and underbody scraper in the amount of $84,835. The total amount for this vehicle is $171,520. And this is as outlined in item 9H.
Support.
I'm sorry, who supported this?
Support.
Councilman Muscat. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it.
Thank you.
We have fire chief.
You're welcome.
Permission to pay Western Wayne County Fire Department Mutual Aid Association.
Madam Chair.
Councilwoman Hicks Clayton.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Move to concur with Fire Chief David Brogan and pay the membership dues for Western Wayne County Fire Department Mutual Aid Association. The total amount is $12,244. $11,000 will come from dues membership, and the remaining $1,244 will come from training, as outlined in 9I.
Support by Councilman Abdullah. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Next, we have Library Director McCaffrey. Request to purchase vehicle.
Council Chair.
Councilman Muscat.
I move that City Council concur with Library Director McCaffrey, request a purchase vehicle as outlined in 9J.
Support.
Support by Councilwoman Hicks Clayton. Is there any discussion?
Council Chair. Madam Chair.
Councilman Abdullah.
I have a question for the director. Be it that you're doing this because of the COVID situation, and I understand, I think it's a good initiative, but I'm just curious, because of the fact that this would probably, and I hope so, obviously nobody can predict the future, but based on everything we're seeing with COVID and the vaccines, et cetera, is it not maybe a better idea to buy used trucks, since this is going to be more of a temporary situation, whether it's 6 months, 9 months, or maybe even a year, just based on the predictions about COVID, instead of buying a brand new one at this point? I don't know if I presume he's here.
Mr. McCaffrey, I'm sorry. Oh, let me unmute you. Hold on. Go ahead.
Hello. So actually, the reason that I'd set the price at what I did at 30,000 is so I could investigate that exact possibility. But even beyond that, we're planning to sort of change our service model a bit to even extend beyond COVID for a little while. One of the things that COVID has helped us do is innovate, try new things, add more of a delivery model to our overall service approach. In addition to not just delivering to households, we were doing something with schools and having an initiative to deliver to them. And as I'd mentioned at the budget hearing, our existing model where, you know, an individual's car can get used for small trips, you know, a meeting or two, you know, a little pickup from a store, that's okay for an individual, but more and more, it's our insurance company does not recommend that library employees use their own vehicles all the time. And but yeah, in terms of what we're looking to do, I'm going to try to find the best vehicle I can for the dollar amount given. At $30,000 or less, we should get a pretty decent vehicle, pretty decent mileage, and we'll try to do the best we can. I cannot definitely say it will be used or new, but I'm going to try to get the best value for the dollar based on that. But I am going to explore that possibility.
Thank you.
Any further discussion?
Council Chair.
Councilman Muscat.
Can we do something like the ordinance department did, is put out the lease of that vehicle? And so the maintenance cost and all of that related is taken care of? I'm not against you purchasing one. I just trying to figure out if that would be a good way to go also.
I had looked into doing that. In terms of getting a lease, if The cost to me seemed kind of high for the vehicles we were looking at.
Okay.
I mean, that could be very different than ordinance. So it seemed that when you extrapolated out the value of the lease, as opposed to the actual value of the vehicle, it didn't seem to quite be as good a deal for the vehicles we were looking to get in terms of a transit. But, you know, again, I'm willing to research that possibility as well and maybe revisit it. But when I was looking at this, and I was looking at this many months ago, before COVID had hit, it didn't seem to be the best option at that particular time to lease based on what we were doing. And again, our situation is very different than what ordinance is doing in other departments. The vehicle we were looking at, the lease didn't seem to work out in terms of the actual cost, if that makes sense.
That's good to know. Thank you very much.
Also, too, I've got a question. Do we have any extra vehicles in the city that are not being used, that were used in the past, that are sitting there that we could possibly use? Have you checked into that?
Not a transit.
Well, in terms of when I'd written in the letter, we had researched this in terms of what vehicles we could use, and there was always something missing. For instance, we want two people to be able to be in the vehicle for delivery reasons, so we want a passenger seat. Some vehicles didn't have a passenger seat. Some vehicles needed a large cargo. We needed a large cargo capacity because we're putting crates of books in this particular vehicle, which is going to have a lot of weight. So that vehicle has to be able to handle a lot of weight. Some vehicles didn't qualify for that. Some needed some kind of a, I keep forgetting what it's called, the metal shield you put to make sure the books don't slide up and hit the driver. That needs to be make sure that that's in the vehicle. We want to make sure it's got a number of different things in it that work. And we also want some degree of quality. I mean, we don't want to get a vehicle from, you know, that's just going to break down on us too quickly, because we're going to try to implement a model of regular service in terms of doing it. But yeah, in either case, we did look at vehicles in the city pool, and it just, they didn't know, none of them really met the qualifications that we needed to accomplish the task in question easily.
Oh, no problem. I understand.
Okay.
Just an idea.
I appreciate it. And yes, we were looking at that.
Okay. Any further discussion?
Madam Chair. Thank you, Madam Chair. I just want to express appreciation and gratitude toward Library Director Michael McCaffrey and his crew, his staff. They've done a phenomenal job during the COVID with providing a service to our residents, continued service, including the home delivery of all these craft kits and things to the families. And I think that's a great job. Well done.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate that. Thank you.
At this time, let's take a vote. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The ayes have it. Next, we have Police Chief Myers' request for payment to DSS Equature Service and Equipment for taping of police phone lines.
Madam Chair.
Councilman Muscat.
I move Council approve the request for payment to DSS Equature Service and Equipment for taping of police phone lines as outlined in 9K.
Support.
Support by Councilor Bazzi. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Next item on the agenda is Police Chief Myers' acceptance of Department of Justice Bureau of Justice Fiscal Year 2020 Coronavirus Emergency Supplemental Funding Program.
Madam Chair.
Councilwoman Hicks Clayton.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I move to concur with Police Chief Mark Myers and accept the Department of Justice Bureau of Justice Fiscal Year 2020 Coronavirus Emergency Supplement Funding Program grant of $55,392 as outlined in 9-11.
Support.
Support by Councilman Muscat. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The ayes have it. Next item on the agenda is Police Chief Myers' request to purchase and pay full face mask, CBRN, canister and filter, and mask carry pouches.
Council Chair.
Councilman Abella.
I move that we concur with Police Chief Mark Myers requesting purchase and payment of the following 80 MSA Millennium full face masks, 80 MSA Millennium CBRN canister filter, and 36 Millennium mask carry pouches. And this would be the total amount for this equipment is $55,336, which will be paid from the BGA Coronavirus Emergency Supplemental Funding Grant as outlined in item 9M.
Support.
Support.
Well, by Councilor Muscat, is there any discussion?
Council Chair.
Councilor Muscat.
I just want to thank Police Chief Myers and Deputy Chief Voiles for their communications with me this past few weeks concerning a lot of the issues concerning coronavirus and other issues. I just want to tip my cap to them and thank them very much for working with me. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? The ayes have it. Next item on the agenda is Deputy Police Chief Indoor Firing Range Cleaning Maintenance Work.
Council Chair.
Council Muscat.
I move council approve the request to purchase and pay indoor firing range cleaning maintenance work as outlined in 9N.
Support.
Support by Councilwoman Hicks. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? The ayes have it. Next we have Corporation Counsel Miyake, Depositories for City Funds, Morgan Stanley.
Council Chair.
Councilor Muscat.
I move that we concur with Corporation Counsel Miyake for the Depositories of City Funds as outlined in 9O.
Support.
Support by Councilwoman Hicks Clayton. Is there any discussion?
Councilor Miyake has his hand raised.
Hold on a minute. Let me unmute too.
Councilman.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, very good. I was just going to want to confirm that the motion would adopt the exact language that's set forth in item 9O for the recommended motion.
Council Chair, then the motion is what Gary Miyake just said, so I don't have to repeat it because I might mess it up anyway.
Okay, do I have a second again?
Yes, support the motion.
Supported by Councilman Hicks Clayton again. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The ayes have it. Next, under ordinances and resolutions, we have Councilwoman Hicks Clayton, resolution of the Dearborn Heights City Council to subpoena records from the comptroller.
Madam Chair.
Councilwoman Hicks Clayton.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I move the City Council adopt the resolution as presented in 11A. This is the subpoena records from the comptroller.
Support.
Support by Councilman Bazzi. Is there any discussion?
Madam Chair.
Clayton, since you made the motion, I'll let you go first.
Thank you, Madam Chair. You know, I want to be very clear about this. Contrary to what the mayor said, you know, it's very clear, the city charter, when you look at section 6.13, the council can request financial records that's to be provided to the council body, as well as in section 8.7. So, you know, this is, though that's regarding the comptroller, but I want the history to be known and on the record that I made every attempt to get this information for, and I know the difference between a year-end financial statement and a monthly expenditure revenue report. We get monthly expenditure revenue reports every single month, 11 months prior, plus the 12th month, which is June. We've done this, in fact, since 2012, 2013, when I first asked about these reports, because I'm very familiar with these reports. Again, it's provided for in the charter. In fact, the mayor asked for a statement from the council. He would have released this information. And the statement he wanted is across the top of these reports. If you read it, I don't know if you can see it. I've got it right here. I'll read it for everybody. It clearly states, note, available balance, budget used does not reflect amounts encumbered. And we know what that means. This is not a year-end financial statement. We know that that will come with the Plant Moran audit information. Okay, this is a record that the council has every right to. I'm very sorry it's come to this, that we have to take a legal action to get a document that's provided for in the charter. And what I want to say is, you know, I know the mayor shared a quote, if I may please. I think she, or in this case he, doth protest too much, and that's William Shakespeare. Thank you.
Okay, next we have Councilman Muscat.
I don't think, I don't understand all of this. Year-end records, I don't know if Comptroller Vance could just give us what we spent and what we took in on just the month of June, regardless if it's year in or year out. I don't understand the difference between the two. So I'm confused at best, and I really don't know what I'm going to vote on here.
We have Councilman Constant next.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just heard Councilwoman Clayton say she wanted the monthly report for June. The next to last paragraph of her resolution says that the Dearborn Heights City Council hereby subpoenas the Comptroller and the Mayor to produce reports of estimated and actual income for all budgetary accounts for the year through June 30th, 2020. So this says the whole year, not the I'm not finished, Councilwoman.
All right.
This says the whole year, not the month of June.
Let's move on. We have Councilman Abdullah, then we have Comptroller Vance. Go ahead, Councilman Abdullah.
Just want to state, I'm going to tell you personally, I've got a problem with how a lot of the stuff that happens on the council happens. It's totally unlike anything else I see in the outside world. I mean, all this fighting back and forth, bickering, and I'm just going to be blunt. Sometimes, accusations or words that are a little bit stronger than maybe I would use in a normal, at least business environment. You know, when you use words like, refuse to, and I'm sorry, Councilwoman, with all due respect, when I was looking at the different emails going back between you and the Comptroller and different council people, there was not one time where she said, I refuse to give it to you. She just said it would not be ready within that time period. Now, you could very well be right, Councilwoman, and I'm not saying you're wrong. And she could be right, or maybe she's wrong. But I didn't see anybody refuse to give it, because the words refuse to give it implies that somebody's got it in their hands and they just don't want to give it to you. I didn't get that vibe or that feeling in any of the emails. And that's where I've got a problem sometimes with the verbiage that's used on the council amongst all of us that just takes us down to a road. Like here, this financial audit right now, because of the butting heads, we spent probably $200,000, $300,000, who knows how many thousand dollars. I mean, I know the council chair, somebody mentioned $100,000, or actually our current treasurer, Zuhair Abdulhaq. I think it's even more than that personally. And I did ask the comptroller how much is it. I think it's more than that. But it's all because of the bickering, this back and forth. And this causes this type of situation. So all I'm saying is, I don't know, just some sort of decorum. And I know that was a word you used before, Councilwoman. And I'm not saying you're not using it. Maybe, and this is not meant against you specifically. I'm talking about as a whole. Okay. I don't believe the comptroller refused, honestly. I didn't see that.
Thank you. Okay, yes. Yeah, so I just kind of want to further elaborate. I haven't prepared this report yet, so it's not that it's not there yet. And I did confer with the previous comptroller, and this report has never been given to council prior to the audit for as many years back as the city can remember. I think it would not be, it's not good to give out numbers that aren't accurate, as I explained in my emails, because I'm doing all the closing processes, and it's a long process. There's a lot of activity at this city. These numbers are going to change daily. So to say the monthly financial for June, that number isn't going to be anything relative to what the audit has done, because I have to do the accruals of the revenue and the accruals of the expenditures. And I'm working hard on that on a daily basis. So to me, giving you a report today, I don't want that out there in the public. The numbers aren't accurate. They're not proper. I don't want that being shared, whatever you want to say, because these aren't the actual true numbers. So to say to give it as of June 30th, I'm not done doing the entries as of June 30th. And that's why the year end one is always given during the audit preparation, because now all my entries have done, the auditors have reviewed it, and on occasion they make entries as well to make sure that these numbers are as best as possible before you present it. No one wants to hand out a piece of paper that is wrong and needs to be corrected. I don't want it distributed and people thinking that this is what our numbers are at. And like I said, I'm not refusing to give it. It's just, it's not customary. It's not best practices in accounting to give numbers that aren't reflective of what actually is what the numbers are gonna be. And I'm just asking for you guys to wait until the process is finished.
But at the same time though, with due respect to Comptroller, you got month number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Mm-hmm. The 12th one is not automatically accumulation of all of them. There's the 12th and it's on its own. And then there's the end part after the end of the month.
Well,
so what the councilwoman is asking for is that 1 month. And I think it's fair to give it to her. I'm not saying it's not fair. I think it's fair to give it to her and to us in general. And maybe there's a little bit of a delay, but I don't necessarily, we don't necessarily need to wait until you accumulated the whole 12 months. Even though it sounds like it's the same, but it's really not.
It is an accumulated report. So
well, that's the end of the year one.
No, I understand, but the report that you're asking, it is accumulated. They're all of them are accumulated. So when I give you, when I give you.
The numbers for the 12th month is by itself. It can be given by itself. The 12th month by itself.
Even if you asked for the activity of the 12th month, it's still not going to be active because if you're just wanting the activity for June, then it's just going to show what expenses have hit that month. They're all accumulative. When you get July 1st, there's really not a whole lot of activity. And when you get August, it's July and August together. And when you get September, it's July, August. So there's no way of not making it cumulative. So it would be a wrong assumption by looking at it. If you looked at it and just compared revenues as of this minute and expenditures as of this minute, their numbers aren't going to be right. It could reflect that one is higher than the other. And 2 days later, it's the other way. Do you know what I'm saying? So it's not a good portrayal of what's going on because of all the adjustments that are done at year end. And the mayor is raising his hand. He'd like to speak.
Councilman Wessel next, and then Councilman Muscat, and then the mayor next. Go ahead, Councilman Wessel.
Yeah, regardless of what these documents contain or how accurate they are, we have the right to see these documents. And I back Councilwoman Hicks on this, regardless of what they contain and what they mean, we have the right to access to them, period.
Can we have Councilman Muscat?
Comptroller Vance, couldn't you just, if you gave a statement out, and I mean any statement, couldn't you just put a disclaimer on the form and say, these numbers are not accurate, blah, 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 and that way it covers whatever you're going to do in the future as far as the numbers changing, and that's like maybe self-protecting yourself for whatever reason, and I don't know if there would be a reason, but maybe that could solve the issue here. I'm trying to figure out somewhere straight down the middle here. Is that possible?
I could do that, but I have another question then. If I give you numbers right now and you're looking at it, then what are you looking at if they're not accurate? What would you want the numbers for as a reference?
I agree.
Okay.
I'm just saying.
Councilman Wenzel's next.
I already made my statement.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Okay, then I've got the mayor next. Well, let me unmute you.
First, I want to apologize for having gotten political, but I felt a great need to defend my department head, who I don't think is fairly coming under attack. It's impossible to have a year-end closing of the city records in 5, let alone 20 days after a year-end. The controller's office is in the process of doing post-closing adjustments. These are very time-consuming, and in the case of revenue recognition, can't be completed for a governmental entity until 60 days after year-end. People with basic financial backgrounds know this. For the rest of the council, if you check with any CPA and ask them if it was reasonable that a city as large as Dearborn Heights would have its financial records all done in 5 or 20 days, they would tell you that is impossible. And I had talked to the council chair, and I thought we had come up with a compromise. And all of a sudden, this thing appears on the agenda and is very vicious in attacking all of us. And Mr. Councilman Abdullah hit it right. All you have to do is ask. We don't hide things from you people, even though you think we do. The concern we have is if, as Controller Vance had indicated, if we provide you data when we know it's not correct, you have every right to come back a month or two and say that you gave us bad data. So what I had talked to the chair about is that each councilman that wanted to receive a preliminary report, that you acknowledge this preliminary report is not correct, the numbers are going to change, and you're not going to disseminate the information because it's incorrect outside the community. And that's and I thought that that was agreeable, and she thought it was a good compromise. Linda was not in the office on Thursday, but we had this discussion late Thursday. I talked to Linda the first day she came back at the department head meeting at approximately 10 or 11 o'clock on Monday. And we were all set to proceed on that basis. Before we even got a chance to, I get a revised agenda with this resolution ripping everybody. And that's why I got mad. So you can understand why I got mad.
Thank you.
Madam Chair. Councilwoman Hicks-Clayton. Thank you. Madam Chair, this is not ripping anybody. And that, talk about strong language. I mean, that actually contradicts what Councilman Abdullah had said. And I agree with Councilman Abdullah. We went through the process. I went through the channels. I asked for it. And yes, I didn't receive it. So maybe refuse is a strong word. But I've been civil this whole time. And I did not come out and attack somebody at the beginning and violate council policies. So we do have a motion on the floor, but nobody's ripping anybody. We have a right to the information.
All right.
Thank you.
We have Councilman Constant, and then we'll take a vote.
The resolution says that for the whole year, for all income and expenses, for all budgetary accounts for the year through June 30th, 2020. I just heard the councilwoman say she wants just June. The resolution says for the year. She's asking for something that doesn't yet exist.
Okay, thank you, Councilman. At this time, let's take a vote. All those in favor, say aye.
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 All those opposed?
No.
Okay, we're gonna have to take a roll call. I have Councilman Muscat.
No.
Councilman Bazzi.
Yes.
Councilwoman Hicks-Clayton?
Yes.
Councilman Abdullah?
No.
Councilman Wenzel?
Yes.
Councilman Constant?
No.
Malinowski Maxwell is yes. It passes. All right, next item on the agenda is new business license renewal for the Stick Carl E. Post 232 located at 23850 Military. We also have the Dearborn Heights Moose Lodge, 27225 Warren, and the Laskawa Post, VFW number 7546, located at 6828 Waverly.
Council Chair?
Councilman Muscat.
Can we take all these together?
Yes.
I move that council approve the business licenses for all that are outlined in 13A.
Support.
Councilman Constant, is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? The ayes have it. Next, we are going to have comments from council members. We'll ask you to limit it to 3 minutes because we went over so late. This has been a long
Council Chair?
Yes. I have Councilman Wenzel has his hand up. Go ahead, please. Councilman Muscat.
Yeah, first of all, I'd like to thank our local South Bend Neighborhood Watch Patrol, Frank Zach, and his sidekick, Grant, who aid with the police department patrolling the businesses and homes and schools in the South End. They're doing a great job. And if anybody would like to help them out with gas cards or any kind of auto maintenance, please contact city council member. They're doing a great job. They're a great asset. They do it on their own. They spend their own money for everything. Two great guys, and they need to be applauded for that. Also, I was wondering if we, because of this COVID thing, and reduce our number of trips to City Hall, if the the mayor and the police chief could go back to having the police department deliver our packets to our homes, which was convenient for everyone. The police are out anyway, and making unnecessary trips to City Hall, and we know something's some positive results that happened at City Hall recently. So it's the limited many trips possible to City Hall would be a great thing. I'd appreciate it myself if I could save a trip with all the things I've got going on. And also with this COVID, we've got a thing called the new normal. And I think one of our new normals in the city of Dearborn Heights should be the new normal of a 5-day work week, City Hall. And I would like all department heads to come up with a plan to return to a 5-day work week in the next 30 days, present it to this council chair. This is something that we might not do, but we're going to do. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next I have Councilman Muscat. Go ahead, please.
Councilman Wenzel stole my thunder, so everything that he said.
Okay. Okay, now we have Councilman Bazzi.
Okay, I have two items. This was brought up a few months ago when we didn't renew the contract for the attorney. Need to know the status. You know, I know it was mentioned with the COVID issue, but I know that every attorney is working right now. So we need to know the status on that, getting a new attorney to represent the council, the city, and the mayor.
Okay. The mayor is no longer here.
There he is.
Hold on that. Yeah. Go ahead,
man. During the COVID, I am not publicly meeting with people. I'm trying to, I do most of my discussions over phone calls. So interviews for such a position or for department heads, I like to do them in person.
Councilman Bazzi?
Well, we're handling official city business on Zoom. I don't know. We can't do that through Zoom. Obviously, we're approving millions of dollars on Zoom meetings. So I don't know. We can't get a new, you know, have you interview a new attorney, you know, through Zoom.
There.
I've responded.
Okay. Thank you. All right, next we have Councilman Constant.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm glad to see City Hall open and the signage up, particularly around the building department and the forms available. And thank you to our building director, Larry Domsky, for putting up all the sneeze guards or whatever you call them, the glass, great job, and the signage. I'm glad to see our parks open, and hopefully our sporting programs will get back and we'll have some sporting activities for our youth. I know we're going to start being able to see baseball games, nobody in the stands, but baseball nonetheless, which I've missed. Regarding the bonding, I hope everyone understands. I've heard some of the council members say, well, we're spending all this money. That sewers are expensive. The sewer system that runs through Inkster, through Dearborn Heights, through Garden City, it's all really one sewer system. It doesn't change at the particular city border. It's these are updates that are mandated, and the only alternative is to go out and bond. And then again, regarding the this resolution to ask the comptroller to produce a year-end financial documents when they're not ready, it just doesn't make any sense. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Any other council people? Councilor Bella?
Madam Chair, just want to make a statement that we had another meeting today. It was a closed meeting, and we've had obviously multiple conversations and calls in regards to the 5G situation. I know a lot of residents have had some concerns in regards to where a lot of these are popping up. I just want to make a statement to the residents that we are doing everything within our powers, and that's a key word, is within our powers. Unfortunately, at the federal government level, the FCC specifically, they've given us practically almost no powers. So I just want to assure you that every city council member is doing everything they can within our powers. And again, that's a key word, to have that either stopped, halted, or at least at the very minimal looked into. And this is one of the statements that the attorney allowed us to say, is that the city has taken the action that is allowed under the state law. And they need state and federal, it needs to be worked on at the state and the federal level, and most specifically the FCC. That's who's going to be able to make some of the changes that some of the residents are requesting. And it's very, very, very unfortunate that we have, sadly and madly, almost no control over this. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, hold on. Okay, hold on. We got the mayor here. Hold on. Go, no. Hold on.
Okay, my on?
Yes.
Yeah, Councilman Abdullah talked about something I want to briefly mention, but we did organize a meeting with the two congresswomen that service Dearborn Heights, and with Rashida Tlaib and with Debbie Dingell, and we did ask for their assistance and help in getting the federal legislation changed on the 5G so that the local control would come back. We have planned a similar meeting with our state representatives and state senators to lobby them also to change the law, which appears to be the best way to get the local control back. The only other item, and please don't unmute me, but I think it was per the charter, I'm supposed to be permitted to speak on all matters that come before this council per the charter. And when you mute me, I'm not able to. The other problem was you talked for a long time on after my veto, but you didn't give me a chance. There's two sides to the story. And I think the public, I'm trying to protect the public's cost related to this. And secondly, I never sued the council on this. The council sued me. And the first time you sued me and the council didn't even vote on it. So I think there's two sides. In all fairness, you should have allowed me to be speak.
Is there any further comment? At this time, I will open it up to public community announcements. Oh, I've got Myers here. Hold on, let me unmute him. Go ahead.
Okay, great, you can hear me. A couple things I want to touch on. First, thank you for realizing how important those grants are. The fire, Lisa Martin at the fire department wrote that BJA grant today. You could saw we used every penny of that grant. Looking over it real carefully, you notice I didn't buy enough pouches as I did gas masks. That's because that's all we could get for the grant. We are trying to accrue another grant with the help of Lisa Martin to pay for the rest of those pouches. So if you see another one for the same type of equipment, it's because we're trying to finish the purchase, but we are trying to secure grants. Director Hashem's probably going to talk in a little bit, I'm assuming, but he's helped us get grants. The police department is very appreciative of all that help, and we're using it to provide better service to our customers, but also to protect our employees because we're running 24/7. Second thing is to make it as quick and as painless as possible, masking up under the new governor's orders. The police department stance is this: it's advise, educate, and enforce. We are going to do our best when we get a call for service to advise the people of what the violation is, what the order is. Then we're also going to try to educate them and help them come up with a solution, whether it's a business owner or something like that. It's ultimately up to them. And then enforce is the last option, and enforce is if we've made those steps to try to advise and people still chose to do it, we will enforce with a ticket. The police department, like many, we are not actively pursuing people that aren't participating in this. We are responding to calls for service. It is, there's too much question to do that and too many opportunities or confrontations that could be involved. So we are responding to calls for service. We are advising, we are educating. And if that does not work, to cut down on our time, if we're spending all this time responding, we will at some point begin to enforce it as we track who we've talked to. But the first step will be to advise and educate. So I hope that answers some of the questions. I had many come in. The governor was nice enough to put that out on a Friday to take effect on a Monday. So 7 a.m., we were coming up with what our mission would be. And then the final thing is, I want to say thank you about the study session today on dispatch. I will let you know that I have asked the city of Dearborn to provide us with what a draft contract would look like so we can start reviewing it. And I know that council would like more talk on it, and I agree with that. But I also, this is something that cannot be kicked down, as you saw by the numbers of both staffing and fiscally. And I have plan on having Corporate Creation Council review the contract, and in the near future, bring it to council to be on the agenda to be discussed and voted on. So out of, you know, so everyone knows that's where I stand, and that is the steps I'm taking at this point.
Thank you very much. Okay, any further public announcements? At this time, community announcements. At this time, I will open up to public announcements. We have Gator that would like to speak. Can we please unmute them?
Yep, I'm just looking for, there we go.
Can you do that? Wait a minute, hold on. I got Director Hashem. Is yours a community announcement, Director? Hold on, I'm still unmuting.
No, it's just a personal comment that I have to make.
Okay, I'll call you after Gator. I'll leave you unmuted though. Sure,
thank you.
Hi everybody, I'll be quick. My name is LaTanya Gator and I attended the city council meeting last month where I proposed maybe that we could have a DEI committee, and I learned that we previously had a DCC commission, Diversity Culture Commission, that was inactive since 2007. And I've been doing my due diligence and trying to see if this type of commission or committee would be beneficial to the community. And I have been getting some positive feedback that some community members do want this to happen in the city of Dearborn Heights. But again, I want to know from you guys on the call, if anybody was around back when the commission was originally founded, what were the pros and cons of what that commission did? And if you guys want to see that be reactivated, what could be some positive things that that commission could do now? If anybody's willing to speak on it.
I wasn't around. Anybody?
I think Vince has his hand up.
It doesn't look like any of us were around back then. we got Councilman Constant.
Mr. Councilman Constant has his hand waving.
Yes. Thank you, Madam Chair. So then Councilwoman Margaret Van Houten, there was an incident in the north end of Dearborn Heights involving some harassment of a African-American resident. I believe, I want to say it was a member of the Detroit Lions and initiated by Councilwoman Margaret Van Houten and joined by really all of us to have the Diversity Commission. And then there was a race going on for district court judge and some people on the council. There was an issue that we got caught up in whether it included LGBT type rights or not, but the commission was formed and met a few times. There was a Wayne County deputy prosecutor who was African American. Her last name was Walker, who was actually friends with Margaret Van Houten, who was active on the commission. I'll have to see if she still lives in Dearborn Heights, but it, like many of our commissions, just sort of faded out of operation, unfortunately.
Thank you, Mr. Constant. Would you be able to speak to what could work for this commission now, and what do you feel the community will most benefit from?
Yeah, we have a, you know, requirements under the charter about forming commissions, and I think we just need to fill any of the vacant vacancies, and then set a a meeting, and the group can elect a chair and so forth.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Again, I'm it'll be helpful to me or anyone else who could be appointed to the commission as to what would we do and how could it be beneficial now in the current times.
Thank you. Okay, next we have Director Hashem.
Good evening, Madam Chair. Good evening, Mr. Mayor. I have a personal comment. I'm speaking as an individual, obviously. My name is Joe Hashem. I live on Wilson Drive. First of all, I'd like to thank DPW because during the heat wave that we had in the last 2 weeks, they did a great job, not just only in my neighborhood, but all around the city, cutting trees and trimming them. And I know it was very difficult. It was very hot outside. So thank you very much, DPW. I'd also like to thank the police department for the increased patrols. I think I see a lot of cars, you know, driving around, which reduces people from leaving and doing some, you know, bad things when there's kids outside. Lastly, as an individual, I'd like to offer a little bit of advice. If you happen to drive on Wilson Drive, which is one of the most beautiful streets in the city of Dearborn Heights, and you see somebody parked illegally or parked in the wrong spot, do not take matters into your own hands. Just call the police. They are very fast, they're very quick, and they know the law. Just call them, and they will respond very quickly, and they will address your needs. That's all I have to say, ma'am. I wish everybody a good night, and all be safe, and thank you very much.
Thank you. And Treasurer
Zuhair Abdelhak. Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. I raised my hand a couple of times as treasurer because I wanted to give my opinion as a treasurer.
Oh, sorry. I'm sorry, I've got to get used to it, but there's a
lot of it's a long night.
One button, it's more obvious than waving
I know,
the screen.
I know.
To catch that.
First, I would like to ask all our residents to help the employees in the treasurer department, especially. Please come and pay any bill you have with a check if possible. That help us, you know, not to sit and count money for long, long time. And that helped the girls really to do their job fast and on time. Second thing, you remember I always spoke about the PEG program and I always ask an opinion from Mr. Mayatke to give me a written opinion if we can pay salaries from the PEG. And I'm asking him right now, in my capacity as treasurer, if you are able to write a veto in 6-7 days, you are able to give me an answer by next meeting. And I ask you officially, please give me a written opinion whether we can pay salaries from the PEG or not. And I appreciate it. So we can settle this issue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Council Chair, do you want me to address that?
Go ahead, I unmuted you.
Okay, I do not normally take direction from the city treasurer with regard to opinions. I will respond to his request for assistance, always will. But if you direct me to do so, or the mayor directs me to do so, but I'll start with Mr. Neil Lato's opinion as a starting point because I believe he's already given an opinion on this and he has more expertise than I do. But if you want me to do it, then Council Chair, I will certainly end up doing it if you direct me to do so.
Okay, thank you.
Should I do it?
I'll think about that. I'll send you an email officially in regards to it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry. I'm trying.
We're trying. Okay, am I muted? Gary, I'd be more than happy to have you give that opinion. I authorize you to do it.
Okay. to shake your head. Okay, because
unmuting
is not working too quick right now. I just started slowing down. Okay, any.
I've got it. I'm good. I'll do.
Okay, you'll do it. Got it. Good. Okay, any further questions?
We have a hand up.
Maher Ibrahim. Maher, where are you?
Hi.
Okay, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Maher Ibrahim. I just wanted to bring an issue that I have to the attention of the council members and the mayor, Mr. Gary. So it's about a dealer that I bought last year. It's something that I've been trying to get up for about almost a year now. So it's a used car dealership that I bought back in October of last year. It's something that I looked for, and I did a purchase agreement in September. I spent a month after that doing my due diligence at the city. It was a used car dealership, been there for years and years and years. So after I got the zoning approval from the building department, I got all the paperwork, I got the CFO. I went and did the actual purchase in October. And after that, I spent a couple months just making sure, doing more remodeling and stuff like that to the dealer. Went back in March to get my license. And then I was told that there's a moratorium in place. And then COVID-19 happened. I had to wait till June till I was able to go back and follow up with the city. I was told again that there's a moratorium in place for new used car dealerships. What I've been trying to argue for a while now that this is not a new car dealership. It was an existing dealer. It's been there for a long, long, long time. So I'm not trying to do any changes to the area or anything like that. I think there was an issue because the prior owner failed to pay like a renewal license last year in March of 2019, which is like months and months before I bought the dealer. And this is something that was not brought up to my attention and all that.
And the council meeting still, I'll call you in a minute.
Yeah. So I think I'm stuck in a very, very unfortunate situation where I bought the dealer and got all my approvals before that moratorium. But due to COVID-19 and all that, I had to apply for the renewal of the license after 2020, which put me in this very, very unfortunate situation. So what I'm asking for in my argument is that I honestly should not and truly believe that this moratorium shall not apply to me, because again, this is not a new car dealership, and I'm not fully understanding why it's done like that. I'm not trying to change anything. And I just also want to, you know, I talked to most of the city councilmen and been trying to go to the city for almost like 9 months now, back and forth. So most of you might have talked to me. I just want to reinforce that I fully respect the moratorium that's in place now.
Abraham, you're at 3 minutes.
Okay.
And I apologize, but we do limit it.
Okay.
Okay. At this time, I am going to call on Galaxy Note 9. I'm not sure who that would be.
Shuyan.
And again, you have 3 minutes limit. Oh, here it is. Okay, you got it. Well, Galaxy Note 9 doesn't have audio on, so we will go on to Chrissy. Where is Chrissy?
I got her.
Okay.
Oh, wait. Did I just hear the Galaxy Note?
Nope, they aren't connecting.
Okay, sorry.
We're not going to delay here. We went too late.
Hi. Okay, I'm going to talk really quick before my birds start talking. I'm Chrissy Leslie. I live on Charlesworth Street. I have two things. To LaTanya Gator, I am going to email you tomorrow because me and a couple other department heads do have a lot of things that the commission could do. The commission was started by a couple people that were really active at the time, one of them being Hamid Sweden, who grew up and went to college. And unfortunately, we lost him for a couple years. We some ideas to help out with neighborhoods and to get not only racial diversity, but understanding with people. So I will email you. I don't want you to think that that some of us don't have some suggestions, because I've got suggestions. Second thing, while my birds are going, and you can probably hear my dishwasher, I am going to mute myself. It's really hard to hear council sometimes, because there's people talking and having conversations in the background and other people moaning, and it's I don't know who, and I'm not blaming anybody on council, but it's really hard to hear you guys sometimes when the person has the floor if other people are talking, in addition to my birds and my dishwasher. So thank you very much, and good night.
Okay, next we have Mr. Parrish. Oh, I'm mute
too.
Go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
Hi, Dana Parrish from Rindley Park in Dearborn Heights. A couple of things, Madam Chair, for you. We're buying lots of new equipment and vehicles in the city. I know lots of stuff is already approved through the budget. Kind of keep in mind that revenue sharing over the next year or so is going to be really tough. I'm sure the federal and state level is going to cut us really severely. And if we can cut anything back, things can be delayed, because we don't know what's going to happen with revenue sharing over the next couple of years. I'm sure these trillions of dollars for bailout money is going to kill us in the city. The next thing is, on July 1st, I sent out a FOIA request, which was really promptly replied to. I sent you, Madam Chair, a copy of that FOIA request. There was a problem, however, in the FOIA request. I requested full legal names, and the reply, I got first and last names, almost no middle names. I got perhaps some initials for names. So if I can get those corrected and get the full legal names as I requested in my FOIA email on July 1st. That was sent to Director Sabota Perry, and it was sent to me by the Mayor's Chief of Staff. And finally, on February 25th, I know this is going back a ways, however, it was at the February 25th meeting, the mayor was asked about an ordinance truck parked at the Target in another city on a Saturday night. The mayor responded that it was a 24/7 ordinance animal control director who was parked there, and he had been taking a dog to his shelter, and he got his clothing dirty from a sick dog. I have a couple of problems there. Number one, a dog was transported to the animal shelter in an unapproved pickup truck. First of all, when you transport an animal, you transport them in an animal transport vehicle, which I believe the city has two of. Number two, animals are to be transported by an animal control officer. Animal control officers are certified by the state of Michigan. That's through the Michigan Department of Agriculture and Rural Development. They have to attend 100 hours minimum of training as controlled under MCL 287.289C. Or the exception to that is a police officer or a person employed as an animal control officer prior to 1973. I'm sorry, sir, but Mr. McIntyre does not fit any of those descriptions. He is not certified under MDAR. He is not a police officer, and he was not employed as such prior to 1973. I have checked. Mr. Mayor, could you respond, please? Why an animal was transported in a vehicle that was not properly contained? And why you have a person acting as an animal control officer who's not certified by the state?
Hold on a minute. It won't unmute. Can you get it, George?
Yep, I can.
Go ahead.
I can get him. I got both of them.
Yeah, my battery is just about dead, so I
can answer that. First of all, there was two of us that traveled to the shelter that night. I did go in my vehicle. I often do that when I'm assisting someone who may be on call that got called in. And so we never said that the animal is transported in my vehicle. And if that was conveyed that way, it's incorrect. So, and by the way, the animal, there were two animals and one of them was deceased, and I could transport an animal if I needed to, a deceased animal in my vehicle. So, and then to answer your question, I actually saw an email that went around regarding your doubt of my certification. And apparently when you called MDARD, because I actually deal with Dr. Shalvin. Somebody called. So I don't know if what name you asked for, but I definitely am certified. I went through the training along with all the other officers. When we, back in 2014, when it was decided that we were going to reopen the Animal Control Department officially, it was my insistence that we, all the full-time ordinance officers, and including myself, go through the training. So I am certified. I don't know what name you gave them, but I'm more than glad to have you
go by.
I'm more than glad to have you come to the counter whenever you like.
How many names did you go by?
Excuse me, I'm talking.
Answer that question. How many names did you go by?
I go by one name. Most people call me Jack, but my legal name is John, similar to John Kennedy, who went by Jack Kennedy. Okay. So you know what, Mr. Parrish, you could have called me anytime. I'm insulted that you would assume that I'm not certified. Since that certification, all of my officers are doing continuing certification. I almost have my national certification in animal control and animal cruelty investigation. So again, I don't know where all this information is going about, but I'm going to speak to that when it's my turn to speak in a second.
Okay, at this time I have Tina Brown. Can we find Tina Brown? I got her. There you go.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I'm not sure if you will remember me from last meeting. I'm dealing with a severe hoarder situation next door. I did speak to Jack McIntyre on Friday, and the property has now been posted. The court, unfortunately, has given them another 7 days to clean up this property. My thing is how in the world, my questions to either council or some type of committee, hopefully, is how is it that this property was allowed to get this bad before it was posted? This is not a short-term issue. This has been going on for 20 years. I moved here 5 years ago, and I first started conversating on a regular basis with the ordinance department last spring. What is it that can be put in place to prevent this issue from happening to this extent in the future? Another issue that I have is what is in place to inform ordinance or proper department when the water is shut off at a property to investigate or ensure that people still are not living at the property? And I think that there's a process that needs to be put in place moving forward for interdepartmental communication and action for further issues. I think that this went on way too long before it was addressed. It was not properly followed up on a regular basis. When I talked to Officer Ortman last year, he agreed with me that these people were gonna continue to be a problem and continue to have been a problem for years. So I think that there should have been a follow-up process in place where these people should have been followed up on long before now, and action should have been taken long before now. And that is my statement.
Okay. Anybody want to remark on that? Thank you, Tina. Any more public comment?
Council Chair.
Councilman Muscat.
You know, I think I raised my hand earlier when the gentleman with the used car lot was speaking.
Oh, I'm sorry.
But that's okay. I understand his frustration. I don't understand what the moratorium has to do with a business that was already existing. It's not a new business. It may be a new owner, but it's not a new business. And I don't think we should penalize that business because of that moratorium of not having new business. Okay. if it was, you know, something, if it was a different type of business, I could understand. But the man has, you know, got his CFO. He got everything. Matter of fact, there's a business that really never have a business license still operating as a hookup business. So why can't this gentleman get his license? Okay. That's my concern. And that's what I got to say.
Okay. Ms. Director McIntyre, did you want to speak? Okay, let me unmute you. Hold on. There you go.
Okay, thank you. Well, first of all, I want to thank Councilman Abdallah for bringing up the elephant that's in the room. I think this has been so chaotic at times, all of us trying to work together. And I'm not quite sure. My background is actually, and if people want to research it, they can. My background's in mental health, and I just feel like we all need to take a deep breath and start really doing the work for the people. We say it, and then we turn around and we do other things. So I just want to reiterate, in 2014, it was suggested actually by the chief of staff, Chrissy Lazel, and the mayor in the mayor's office, that we train our ordinance officers to take on the responsibility of animal control. It's a huge responsibility. The training is extensive. It is 100 hours. And in addition to the 100 hours, the goal that I set was that we do additional hours. So everybody is evaluated by Michigan Humane Society's shelter. If you're going to be an animal control officer in this department, we have to make sure that you're comfortable dealing with animals. So everybody goes and they're evaluated first by the Michigan Humane Society. And then that information comes back. If they meet the requirements to be an animal control officer, then we start the training. When they become a full-time officer in our department, they have 6 months to complete the training. We've hired a company called ACES. They put all of us through the training. It was very brutal. Our first day on the job, we had 3 pit bulls that were literally charging us. All of us were very nervous, but we were training and we do it consistently. And I'm actually kind of glad that Mr. Parrish brought this up, because I was really stunned when I saw an email circulating around questioning whether or not I have the qualifications or the certification. And I'm like, seriously, we're going to go to this level? It's so easy to verify. And I'm sorry that my mother liked John Kennedy, and also liked that John Kennedy went by Jack Kennedy. That's what she did with me. She named me John and she called me Jack from day one. So I have a certificate. I'll be glad to show it to anybody that wants to come. I respond to all the animal calls all weekend long. You can verify that with the police dispatch. I get multiple calls all weekend long. We do good things for the community with animal control. We started hosting vaccine clinics here at City Hall where we offer very cheap vaccines for people. And what's interesting, and this just came up in a conversation today when I was in HR, like other first responders, these guys are first responders too. They do a very critical job in our community. And sometimes they don't get the recognition. So I will be glad to post my certificate on Facebook if that's what's necessary. But I am really, really tired of the accusations. I'm tired of being asked, why would I accept food? I mean, I was actually accused of taking food at my counter.
We are at the 3-minute limit. I apologize.
That's fine. That's fine.
Okay. Anybody else? Any other? Okay. Do I hear a motion to
adjourn?
Support.
Support by Councilman Bazzi. Councilman Bazzi motion, supported by Councilman Muscat. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you, everyone. Have a good night.
Thank you.